click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends, I welcome you all to the subject Electromagnetic Field Theory. We are with chapter number 10, that is the uniform plane waves. Right from the last chapter, we are well familiar with the Maxwell's equation. Initially, we have the Maxwell's equation for time constant fields, then for the time varying fields. Now, this chapter we started with the Maxwell's equation in the form of phasors. So, the phasor form of Maxwell's equation we have used to get the regarding information of electromagnetic wave, hence we derived the wave equations. So, initially we had the wave equations for general conducting medium. We found the solution for that particular one with the parameters giving the information regarding wave propagation, naming them alpha, beta, gamma, eta, the velocity of propagation v and the lambda wavelength. We have the wave propagation with respect to the perfect dielectric medium. We have seen the term loss tangent, which categorizes the medium in which the wave propagation is occurring, whether it is of conductive type or dielectric type. So based on all these things, we have practiced some numerical statements also. Now it is time to talk about the power associated or the flow of energy associated with the electromagnetic wave. Because we say that electromagnetic wave carries information from one place to another place, it is the best thing to carry communication into the systems. So that is why the power associated, the energy associated with the wave has to be addressed, and it has been addressed by the scientist named John Henry Poynting. So it is called as nowadays the Poynting's theorem, and very important as far as the curriculum at degree level is concerned. So let us see the Poynting's theorem and wave power. So for deriving the Poynting's theorem and to see how the wave power is having behavior while the wave propagates into the certain medium, so for that purpose we take the help of Maxwell equation. Right now we take the help of Maxwell equation into the time domain. So Maxwell's first equation, we have del bar cross of h bar given by the addition of conduction current density and displacement current density. So conduction current density is represented by simply j bar, whereas the displacement current density we used to write by del d bar by del t, or we can write epsilon in multiplication with the partial derivation of electric field intensity with respect to the time. So let us give it equation number one. This is the Maxwell's first equation into the time domain. Now we have the left hand side, the curl operation, the rotation of magnetic field intensity, and onto the right hand side, the summation of the current densities. Now if you like to trace the dot product with E bar vector, so a dot product on both the sides with E bar vector, if you take, so that time the equation number one will be modified to the next step. So the next step I can show you here, we first of all write E bar, so it has a dot operation with del bar cross of h bar, what used to be the LHS of equation number one. Now on to the right hand side we have two terms, hence E bar will be having dot multiplication with both the terms. E bar dot of j bar will be the first term now, and the second term will be E bar dot multiplication with epsilon times del E bar upon del t. So let this will be the equation number two. So from the first equation, Maxwell's equation, we have modified to this form, and onto the RHS we found E bar dot of j bar and E bar dot of this partial time differentiation of electric field intensity. Now for the left hand side where we have the three vectors, so E bar electric field intensity, magnetic field intensity H bar, both are vectors, and this operator is also of vector nature. So for that purpose we remind one vector identity. So in general, if the vectors are denoted by A bar cross of B bar, so the vector identity del bar dot of, in bracket, if we show the two generalized vectors A bar cross of B bar, it is given by B bar dot operation with curl of first vector A bar minus AMR dot operation with the kernel of second vector B bar. So this is from the vector identity. This you can treat to be the part of the first chapter, that is vector analysis required to understand all the electromagnetic field theory. So here, if we substitute A bar is equal to electric field intensity vector E bar, and the second vector B bar is equal to the magnetic field intensity vector H bar. So that time the representation will be quite like this. So del bar dot operation with, in the bracket here we have the cross product of E bar with H bar. So this results into the RHS, we first of all have H bar, in the bracket the curl operation of electric field intensity minus E bar dot operation with the curl operation of magnetic field intensity. So now we have E bar dot of the curl operation of H bar. So this is nothing but the left hand side of equation number 2. Hence, if you get it onto the left hand side, this will become E bar dot operation with del bar cross of H bar given by H bar dot operation with the curl of E bar minus the del bar dot of E bar cross of H bar. So this has become the form by using this particular vector identity for equation number 2. So now in the equation number 2, for the left hand side, if we substitute this particular right hand side, so the new equation we can write, it will be H bar dot operation with del bar cross of E bar minus del bar dot of E bar cross of H bar. So it will be given in the terms of E bar dot of J bar plus E bar dot operation with epsilon of del E bar by del T. Now if you take this term only onto the left hand side, shifting this one to the RHS, we get minus del bar dot of E bar cross of H bar will be given by, the first term will be E bar dot product with J bar, the second term will be E bar dot product with epsilon times partial differentiation of E bar with respect to the time, and the third term here, that is shifting of this particular term from LHS, will give us minus of H bar dot operation with del bar cross of E bar. So here we have del bar cross of E bar to the third term of this particular equation. Now if we shall use the Maxwell's second equation, so before that I mention here this is equation number 3. So to the third term of the equation number 3 onto the right hand side, if I use the Maxwell's second equation, so Maxwell's second equation into the time domain is nothing but del bar cross of E bar is equal to minus del B bar upon del T. In terms of magnetic field intensity, if you need to write, so that time we shall be multiplying the mu first of all, and in place of B bar we shall be writing H bar. So this becomes the form. So in the bracket we have del bar cross of E bar operation. So in place of that, if we substitute this new bracket, minus mu del del T of H bar. So that time the equation 3 will become, to get the form that I write, so it will be minus del bar operation dot with E bar cross of H bar will be given by E bar dot of J bar, the first term. The second term will be E bar dot multiplication with epsilon times del E bar upon del T, and the third term will become, it will be the minus minus plus sign, and H bar dot multiplication with mu times the partial differentiation of again H bar with respect to the time. So if you get back to the problem, to the equation number 3, so this minus sign has resulted into the plus sign. H bar is already there in the bracket, in place of del bar cross of E bar we have this mu into del H bar upon del T. Now we have the three terms onto the right hand side. Okay, so if we take the second term here, so second term is E bar dot operation with epsilon times del E bar upon del t. So that time it involves two vectors, the original vector electric field intensity and the time rate of change of electric field intensity vector. So both being having the same directions, the resultant what we get we can directly write in terms of magnitude only. Therefore this we can write E bar into epsilon, it will be partial differentiation of magnitude of electric field intensity with respect to the time. So dot operation has resulted with respect to only the magnitude. Here I must put E only. Now if you multiply these terms by 2 upon 2, so we shall be writing 1 upon 2 epsilon into 2 times E into del E upon del T, which further we can mention 1 upon 2 epsilon times del E square upon del T, as we can take del T outside. So this becomes del T, the partial differentiation with respect to the time. In the bracket, we shall get multiplication of epsilon, that is permittivity of the medium, with E square divided by 2. Hence, the middle term, the second term into the RHS, we can write in terms of the partial differentiation with respect to time for epsilon E square upon 2. So we can have the similar substitution for the third term also in terms of magnetic field intensity. Therefore, here we replace E bar dot epsilon del E bar by del T by del T of in the bracket epsilon E square upon 2. Similarly, we can mention H bar dot of mu times del H bar upon del T will be given by, it will be del T in the bracket mu H square divided by 2. So if we do two replacements into the above equation, so this was the equation, so these two terms have to be changed. Hence this particular equation gets to the form I write here minus del operator having dot multiplication with the cross product of E bar and H bar given by onto the RHS. The first term will be the same, that is E bar dot of J bar, plus the second term will be here. It will be del T in the bracket epsilon E square upon 2, plus it will be again the partial differentiation with respect to time for mu H square divided by 2. Now let us denote this my equation number 5 if we do. So now here we have all in the terms of differentiations. Here the spatial differentiation with respect to the XYZ axis we can say. Here the differentiation with respect to the time here we have. So now if we integrate this with respect to the space parameters, or moreover if we say integrating both sides of this particular equation onto the volume of this particular space, we can write it will be minus sign first of all. So for del bar dot of E bar cross of H bar, we shall write it will be volume integral, means the triple integral in the bracket. Here we have the del bar dot operation with E bar cross of H bar, the curly bracket is completed, along with the differential volume dV. So it shall be given by, the first term will also be the volume integrated. It will be E bar dot J bar into differential volume. The second term will be again given by volume integral, the time derivative of epsilon E square divided by 2 into dV. Likewise, the third term will be the volume integral del T of mu into H square divided by 2 into dV. So we have got the equation formed to this one. Now if you see here, to the second and the third term onto the right side, right hand side of this particular equation, we have the integration with respect to dV, that means volume. So it is a measurement of space parameters. The dV we can replace with dx dy dz. The multiplication of the three dimension will give us the differential volume here. So similarly, we can do it here, but we have the time differentiation, the differentiation of this particular magnitude bracket term with respect to the time. So we know that time and the space coordinates are independent of each other. That is why to the next step, we shall be changing the order of these particular operations, and the application of divergence theorem we shall be using to represent this particular equation. I remind you, the divergence theorem for any general vector, the closed surface integral A bar dot of ds bar will be given by the volume integral divergence of A bar into dv. So now here onto the left hand side, del bar dot of this particular bracket. So this bracket is the cross product. We have seen that in the first chapter, the cross multiplication of the two vectors result into the third vector, whereas the dot multiplication of the two vectors results into the scalar, which has magnitude only. So del bar dot of a vector is nothing but the divergence. Hence, if we treat it to be the divergence of certain vector A bar, okay, so we will be having some different representation for this particular bracket. So this is nothing but the right hand side of this particular divergence theorem. We can write it in terms of closed surface integral that particular bracket vector into ds bar. Similarly, we can make the changes, as we have said that changing the order of, we shall first of all take the time differentiation, then the volume integral. Hence the new form of this particular equation using the divergence theorem and changing the orders, we shall be getting minus sign as it is. It will be closed surface integral, means the double integral. Here we shall be obtaining E bar cross of H bar, and this has dot product with the differential surface ds bar. Hence the RHS, the first term will be having no change. It will be volume integral. Here we have in the bracket, we have the dot operation with E bar dot of J bar into the differential volume dv. The second term, we shall be having the first of all the time differentiation. So being the time, the independent quantity, I write here the ddt, not the partial differentiation. And in the bracket, here I mention the volume integral. So volume integral will be applicable to epsilon capital E square divided by 2 into dv here. Similarly, the third term also, I write first of all the time differentiation. So ddt in the bracket, it will be volume integral, and it will be applicable to mu h square divided by 2 into dv. So let us say this is equation number 6. Now this equation is having the three terms onto the right hand side. So I shall be mentioning this is the first term onto the RHS, second term onto the RHS, and the third term onto the RHS that are added up. So I shall show you with the different color here, the terms 1, 2 and 3. Now let us discuss about the significance or the information that is conveyed by these three terms that are representing the summation for the right hand side of this particular equation number 6. Now talking about the first term, it is having the dot multiplication of E bar and J bar. Now we know that E bar is electric field intensity and J bar is the cross sectional current density. We know that E bar dot of J bar, if we take, so for E bar, the SI system of units is having the unit that is volts per meter, whereas J bar, the cross sectional current density, is having how much current with respect to the surface area, hence ampere per meter square. So simply we shall be having the multiplication of the two, so it results into volts into ampere. So voltage into the current is nothing but the power. So that we can write into the wattage, power or energy you can say. Here the denominator is having meters and here meter square. So it is nothing but wattage per meter cube. So if you see wattage per meter cube given by the dot multiplication of electric field intensity with the current density. So this gives us the power per unit volume at the specified point into the wave propagation for the given medium, you can say. Now if we have this particular dot multiplication is having the volume integral. Hence, if you have the volume integral, so that time this will give us the instantaneous power in the volume, and in terms of fats, that is dissipated as I square R losses. Now initially E bar dot of J bar was wattage per unit volume. So integrating it onto the volume will simply give us into the wattage. Hence this will result into the I square R losses into the medium of propagation. Therefore, in general, we can say that the first term of equation number 6, the first term of this equation number 6 gives us the information regarding the instantaneous power entering the closed surface, that is to be dissipated as I square R losses. So for having the volume integral, we have considered a closed surface incremental one from the space. So that is why it is the instantaneous power that enters the closed surface, because initially there is no such power that has brought by the propagation of electromagnetic wave into that one. Hence, instantaneous power entering the closed surface to be dissipated as I square R losses. So first term that we have introduced. So first term we are discussed about. Now talking about the second term. Now in the second term, here we have epsilon E square divided by 2. So that has been volume integrated, and further it has been time differentiated. So now talking about the epsilon into E square divided by 2, it actually gives us the energy density in the electric field of the wave, because electric field, so that is electric field is measured into the volts per meter. Hence the E square into epsilon divided by 2 will result into the energy density in the electric field of the wave. Now when we integrate it onto the entire volume, so as we stated, it was energy density. So density integrated with the complete volume, so it will be the energy stored into the electric field intensity for the particular volume integral. So now it is the energy stored in the terms of, or because of, the electric field intensity, or simply electric wave you can say, because the electromagnetic wave is having the two parts. First one, the electric represented by E, the magnitude one, and the second one is magnetic wave represented by H. So this is the energy stored because of the electric wave. Now if we have further the time differentiation of this particular term, so that time we shall say that this particular term gives us the instantaneous rate of increase of energy into the electric field of the wave for the volume integral. Because if you say, so the energy stored initially we shall be writing into the joules, and taking the time differentiation, so it will be joules per second, that is nothing but the watts. Therefore the instantaneous rate of increase of energy stored I will be saying, because we have positive sign here, if it would be the negative sign, we shall be talking about the decrease of. Hence as the wave is entering into the medium, so it brings to that particular closed surface what we have considered. Hence the increased rate of energy stored into the electric field will be given by this particular term, that is the second term into equation number 6. Now talking about the third term, here we have ddt of volume integral of mu h square divided by 2 dv. So as like we have discussed for this particular term, talking about mu h square divided by 2, so I shall write first of all mu h square divided by 2. So this gives us the density in magnetic field intensity. Magnetic field intensity we measure into amperes per meter. So per meter is there. So now we are taking the square of this magnitude. So H square into mu divided by 2. So this gives us magnetic field intensity, density, energy density. Now when this energy density is integrated over the volume, so we shall say that this is the energy stored in the terms of magnetic field intensity, or the energy storage of the magnetic wave simply you can say. Further, taking the time differentiation for this particular bracket, So it is as like the second case we have discussed. So this is the rate of increase of the energy storage into the magnetic wave. So this increased energy from the magnetic wave enters the closed surface into consideration, where we are supposed to carry out this volume integral. Volume integral is nothing but the triple integral. All the three dimensions of the closed surface we have considered, that will be applicable to the limits of this particular integration, and we shall be getting the total term. Now we have discussed all the three terms here, so we can revise that. For the first term, it is the instantaneous power entering the closed surface, and that is to be dissipated as I square R losses. The second term is rate of increase of instantaneous energy stored into the electric wave, and this is for the magnetic wave. Hence, the LHS of equation number 6 we can write in general. So LHS is given by minus closed surface integral. Here we have E bar cross of H bar dot operation with ds bar. So the RHS, what we had, the three terms. So this is the total instantaneous power entering the closed surface. So we have here minus sign. So if we take positive sign, if we change the sign, so the closed surface integral E bar dot E bar cross operation with H bar dot of ds bar will be the total instantaneous power leaving the closed surface. So I mentioned here total instantaneous power leaving the closed surface. So now we have the resultant vector for this particular, the instantaneous power leaving the closed surface, taking the positive sign, is nothing but the resultant of this particular cross multiplication. So E bar cross of H bar will be the third vector. So here we mention E bar cross of H bar is nothing but the third vector, that we denote by P bar. So if we have volts per meter for electric field intensity, now ampere per meter for the magnetic field intensity. So P bar having the multiplication of volts into the current, that is ampere. So it is nothing but the watts per meter square. So this gives the instantaneous power per unit area at the point, that is power density at the certain point. Hence, in general, what we write, that is I outline it separately, P bar is equal to E bar cross of H bar in terms of watts per meter square. Now this is a vector quantity along with the magnitude. It has a certain direction. Now the direction is determined by the cross product. In the first chapter, vector analysis, we have gone through the cross product. So if the cross product is to be taken place, the resultant direction is found by using the right hand thumb rule or right hand screw rule. The plane in which these two vectors are lying, so the resultant direction is always perpendicular to that particular direction. Hence, in general, if we draw the wave model to have E bar into the y component, y axis, H to have x component, that means along the x axis, the perpendicular direction to the xy plane will be the z direction. And we have already shown with the diagram, I can redraw here, taking the help of the three axes. So I don't follow the right-handed coordinate system here. These are the two axes, and the third axis is like this. So in this case, the first component of electric wave, or the first wave I can say, so this is E bar. This is E bar wave, and it is along the y axis. This is x axis. And along this particular axis, the orientation will be of the another vector field. So that is nothing but the magnetic field intensity. So magnetic field intensity wave is having the variation into the yz plane, that is horizontal plane, and the electric field intensity is having variations into the, sorry, this was in xz plane and this is having the orientations or variations into the yz plane, that is vertical plane. So the resultant direction in which the wave carries forward, that is the z axis. Hence P is equal to E bar cross product with H bar gives us the information regarding the instantaneous power per unit area in terms of watts per meter square. So we have seen the cross product, the cross multiplication of electric field intensity vector and the magnetic field intensity vector is giving us the resultant direction in which the wave propagates forward, and it is the same direction in which the power is also flowing. So it is the direction of power flow associated with electromagnetic wave. So this was our Poynting's theorem finding. So from these Poynting theorems, as the role is of two vector quantities, that is electric field intensity and magnetic field intensity, into the phasor form, if in the diagram we represent the two vectors, so it will be looking like, so here we consider the imaginary axis and the real axis. So this being the real part, this being the imaginary part, right from this point, if we denote the representation of electric field intensity vector, that is the phasor form, so this will be ES bar. Now we can have the similar orientation of HS bar like this. Here we know that they ideally should have 90 degree angle with each other, so we have represented phasors of the both. Now if with the real axis they are making certain angles, so this angle for the magnetic field intensity phasor with the real axis we shall designate by the symbol theta suffix h, whereas for the electric field intensity vector we shall designate by theta suffix e. The difference of the two will give us the angle between HS bar and ES bar into this plane, and that will be given by theta suffix eta, that is given, that is theta e minus theta suffix h. Now onto this particular side, if you have the projection, so that time we can show the complex conjugate of the magnetic field intensity vector also. We can denote it, the phasor, with the asterisk here. So in the general, for the phasor form, the equations we represent, we have shown them into the diagram. ES bar will be given by capital E bar into e to the power minus alpha z e to the power j times minus beta z plus theta suffix e. So the angle we have considered, and HS vector, that is the phasor form, we can represent H bar e to the power minus alpha z e to the power j times minus beta z plus theta suffix h. So now the phasor form representation we have done, representing E bar and H bar, the electric field intensity and magnetic field intensity, into the real time fields, we can show them with the help of cosines. So E bar in general, so will be E bar, so the magnitude you can consider, so e to the power minus alpha z cosine of omega t, or you can apply the suffix 0 also here, cosine of omega t minus beta z plus theta suffix e will be here. It will be in terms of volts per meter. Similarly, the magnetic field intensity vector representation in the real form can be denoted by h bar e to the power minus alpha z into cosine of, in the bracket, omega t minus beta z plus theta suffix h. So this is in the terms of ampere per meter. Now the instantaneous power that we have represented by the vector symbol P bar, so it is given by E bar cross product with H bar. electric field intensity and magnetic field intensity into the cross operation. So substituting all of them, so that time we obtain the instantaneous power density of the wave given by P bar is equal to, I write it onto the separate page. So this will be P bar. The magnitudes what we have written, so it will be E bar cross of H bar divided by 2 in multiplication with e to the power minus twice alpha z it will be, and in the bracket here we have the cosine of twice omega t minus twice beta z plus theta suffix e plus theta suffix h, bracket is completed, plus it will be the cosine of theta suffix eta. So theta suffix eta that we have represented into the diagram, the difference of the two angles, and this will be again in the unit watts per meter square. So this is the instantaneous power density with respect to the area. Now if you talk about the average power density, so for average power density it will become P suffix AV, I denote for the average power density, it will be given by E bar cross of H bar divided by 2 into e to the power minus twice alpha z into cosine of theta suffix eta. So this will be again into the wattage per meter square. So this is the average power density. Now further, if you use the only magnitudes of E bar and H bar, because we know that E that is vector, H is also a vector. So magnitudes if you concern, if we are interested about the magnitude of the power density only, so that time this we shall write in the terms of P suffix AV will be given by E into H simply divided by 2 e to the power minus twice alpha z cosine of theta suffix eta. So no concern of direction. So substituting in the terms of intrinsic impedance, we have E is equal to eta into the mod, you can say H. So eta is actually the ratio of amplitude of electric field intensity to that of the magnetic field intensity. So E in terms of eta H and H in terms of E upon eta. So this substitution, if into this particular equation if you make, so the power density can also be represented as P suffix AV will be given by capital E square divided by twice mod of eta e to the power minus twice alpha z cosine of theta suffix eta, or it can also be represented as mod of eta into H square divided by 2 e to the power minus twice alpha z cosine of theta suffix eta. So both are the representation into wattage per meter square. So this is the average power density. Now most of the times we have the medium in which the wave propagation occurs to be the free space medium. For a free space medium, we know that the attenuation constant ideally is equal to zero, as well as the difference, that is the theta suffix eta, will also be equal to zero. Therefore, the average power density P suffix AV for the free space will be EH divided by 2, will be nothing but E square upon twice eta, or eta into H square divided by 2 watts per meter square. So I hope the formula of average power density or the instantaneous power density will be helpful to us solving the problem statements based on to the Poynting's theorem and wave power. So into the subsequent videos we shall be using this formula to solve certain problem statements. For getting such more information and practicing problems onto such a subject, that is electromagnetic field theory, you can subscribe to EKIDA channel. Thank you.